video from CBS Fox Video Sports. ABC Sports presents Gymnastics, Greatest Stars. Three decades of great moments in gymnastics history on ABC Sports.
When you consider gymnastics' greatest stars, their names certainly shine. Olga, Nadia, Mary Lou, Kurt Thomas, Kathy Rigby, and so many more. Over the past 30 years, these talented athletes have become more than just great gymnasts. They've charmed us, dazzled us, and even stolen our hearts. We'll meet them again like old friends who've given us something special.
We'll look back at the classic rivalries that inspired outstanding performances which define perfection or near perfection in the eyes of both the judges and the audiences. And we'll relive the breakthroughs of those Americans who managed to penetrate the inner circle of the Eastern Bloc elite. And from these stars have sprung great moments that stand out in time, like Olga's backflip catch on the uneven bars.
Now watch this, watch this. Backs somebody right to the other bar.
It's at these times that new eras begin and new definitions of state of the art are born.
We'll bring you all of this played out against the backdrop of dramatic personal sagas, Cold War turmoil, and the almost constant controversy over the politics of judging.
When ABC Sports first began covering gymnastics, even the national championships were intimate gatherings. These were the early 60s and the beginnings of the modern era of the sport. It may not look the same, the floor exercise was more dance than tumbling. The rings were strung from the ceiling, and at this point in time, the emphasis was on strength. Only rarely did you see great swinging moves on the rings. No event has changed as much from its inception as the women's uneven parallel bars. The bars then were narrowly separated, had little spring in them, and it was customary to pause between big moves. The event lacked the sweeping, fluid movement from bar to bar. That is, until Doris Fuchs-Brauss. This was Dortmund, Germany, the World Championships, 1966. Doris, an American, was returning to the country of her birth, and the routine she brought with her would revolutionize the sport. This move right here, a front somersault from the low bar, catching the high bar while upside down, no one had ever done that before, and in fact, the move would be named for her. But there was more than just one stunning move here. The routine was 10 years ahead of its time. It flowed from one bar to the other, developing a continuous rhythm with rare pauses. To put it in the language of the sport, it was the first time anyone had swung bars. At the finish, there was a roar from the crowd. The judges, maybe caught off guard, didn't know what to make of it. Her score was low. The crowd booed and whistled, interrupting the meet for an hour. Doris did not even make the finals.
At the 1968 Olympic Games in Mexico City, Vera Chavzlaska of Czechoslovakia was the grand dame of the sport. She had already celebrated winning the all-around for the second straight Olympic Games. With this vault, she began her quest for four individual gold medals.
And that was a near-perfect vault.
She won the vault and the unevens easily, but then a controversial decision by the judges cost her the gold on the beam. It appeared there was more going on here than sport itself. 2 months earlier, the Soviet army had overrun Chavzlaska's homeland of Czechoslovakia.
These are the floor exercises. Four girls within 1/10 of a point going into the final here, a gold medal on the line.
And here, politics would enter the games for the second time, for when Soviet Larisa Petrick finished, her score of 9-9 gave her a total score just behind the leaders. Indeed, as Chavzlaska stood poised on the mat, the last to perform, it was Kuczynskaya she thought she had to beat, and a 9-9 would do it.
Oh, a beautiful, high, full-twisting back somersault. The best in this competition.
The Mexican hat dance is not calculated to displease the audience here in Mexico City.
They love it. Jim, that's a 10 if I've ever seen it. Perfect exercise.
the Jam National Auditorium in Mexico City, awarding by their applause the gold medal to Vera Chaslovska. She got the 9-9. Chaslovska has won her fourth gold medal.
Or at least, that's what she thought.
We return to the National Auditorium. The officials have changed the figures that were given out before this event, going into the final round. They have corrected the previous score of Larisa Petrick and have announced that it is a tie for the gold medal between Vera Chaslovska of Czechoslovakia and Larisa Petrick of the Soviet Union.
What had just transpired was almost unheard of. After the event, officials announced that they'd been wrong all along, that Petrick's preliminary scores should have been higher entering the finals. So now Chaslovska would have to share the moment that was to have been hers alone.
And now the Soviet anthem. And again, she has turned her head to the right and down, just as she did at the last ceremony. This does not appear to be an accident.
Clearly, it was an act of public defiance in the face of Soviet tanks that had so recently crushed the Czechoslovakian uprising. Her act carried a personal price. She returned home to find herself an official outcast, forced to live in relative isolation, her career finished. But among her countrymen, Vera Chaslovska became a national heroine for publicly defying the Soviets while the world watched.
In 68, the Japanese men, with their precision and consistency, dominated the Olympic Games. Well, the most dominant of all was Sawao Kato, because he added something else. He added style. For years
circles,
to come in the all-around, Kato would tower over them all.
We'd repeat that the Japanese have wrapped up the team championship. It's the individual all-around that's in question here. To the inexpert eye, he looks awfully good, Tom.
The way he's going, he's got a chance for that 9.85. I think this is going to determine it, this finish. And he hit it. He did. He hit it.
And there it is, a 9.9 for Kato of Japan. He has come from behind on the final exercise. He knew what his Russian opponent had done. He knew what he had to do. He has won the Olympic gold medal.
I don't think you'll ever see a more confident 15-year-old.
Early on, Kathy Rigby, with spring in her legs, a dancer's grace, and a pixie's smile, demonstrated the talent that would become evident at the 1970 World Championships.
For the first time in history, the United States has placed an athlete, either male or female, in the finals of a world competition. Her name is Kathy Rigby, and they've come to love her over here.
A very difficult beginning, a press to a handstand with straight arms. Very few girls can do this movement. The big thing here is to work, you might say, as though you were working on the floor. Complete control with no loss of balance. Beautiful walkover and a one-arm walkover. So far, Kathy is doing very well. Upright scale showing great flexibility. A difficult one-arm walkover. And a full twisting front somersault. A great exercise.
Kathy Rigby of the United States has made her effort. She's the first performer. She'll become the temporary leader, but the important thing is how high that mark is. Coach Muriel Grossfeld apparently quite pleased with the way Kathy did, and now she can collapse just a little bit. The crowd indicating that they like that performance and that they want to see a high mark or else they'll start to whistle.
For nearly 2 minutes, the judges conferred. They weren't accustomed to giving Americans marks like these.
Well, here comes the scoreboard flickering on. 9.70 for Kathy Rigby. A very good score. It's all official now in Yugoslavia. On the victory platform stands little Kathy Rigby. And the number under her says 2. That means she won the silver medal.
Did you really have hope of a silver?
No, I didn't even think I'd get a medal because I was first up and
when you're first up, usually the scores aren't as high. And it's hard wading through all those people.
I'll bet it was. Congratulations to you, and on to Munich now. Maybe the next one will be gold.
Right. It was not to be. Someone else would steal the limelight.
Olga Korbut is 17 years old, a little teenage girl who has suddenly come from a place called Grodno, Byelorussia, to perform before 11,000 people in the Olympic Games.
Jim, if she hits, you won't believe that she's the second best on her team. Now watch this. Watch this. Back somebody right to the other bar.
Has that been done before by
never,
a girl?
Never. Not by any human that I know of. Look at that. And she's second best. I don't believe it.
This, then, is a historic performance you're watching right now in gymnastics.
She's Kathy Rigby's size. Oh, my. Wow!
Olga Korbut, who may well be on her way to winning the individual all-around championship, by the way. The marks here in the team championship count towards the individual, which will be decided on Wednesday.
Yeah, I'm raising my hands, too.
Many of the crowd on their feet here in the Sporthalle in Munich. The Olympics have really come to life, and they're booing and whistling that she only got 9.70. You think it could have been higher?
I gave her 11. All right, here we go. Watch this little thing. This gives me chills. Back somersault. Imagine the tolerance for error. Wow, what a sensation. Hey, this crowd is not going to let them keep that score.
Olga may have already captivated the audience, but it was her teammate, Ludmila Tereshcheva, a classically pure gymnast, who was the reigning world champion in the all-around. And as Tereshcheva began the competition for the all-around title with this vault, she was the co-leader. Sharing the lead was Karen Jantz, a 20-year-old medical student from East Germany. Jantz had finished fourth behind Tereshcheva in the World Championships 2 years earlier in Ljubljana. It didn't take Olga long, though. After just one rotation, the lead was hers.
And now Olga Korbut moving to the piece of equipment on which she made a little bit of history two nights ago.
Oh, look at that. Right off the bat. Oh, that's a shame. And now she's in such a tight fight for the championship. Here we go. There's a back summit to the catch. Wow. Even with her mistake, she's still revolutionizing gymnastics.
Point out specifics when you can.
I sure will. She just dropped. There's another mistake. Poor kid. You know, this is what we talk about seasoning.
Nope, she's just lost it all. Lost her composure.
Jim, this is what
happened. At age 17. The world championship very much in her grasp, and she probably lost it right there. Olga Korbut, a long way from her home in Byelorussia, trying to fight back the tears. There it is, 7.50, so you can drop poor little Olga Korbut way, way down the line. Two full points in gymnastics is total disaster.
And so Tereshcheva needed only a 9.45, nothing really, in the third rotation to hold on to the lead. This break, though, cost her. And now the lead fell to Jantz, beginning the last rotation. And here, Jantz had the advantage of performing on her best apparatus.
Wow, look, look. What flair. All she has to do is put all this exercise together and then see if the other girls can go through without making mistakes. This gal's a real athlete. Real pretty athlete, too. Oh, a little problem, but it's not going to be a biggie because it's a difficult move. Full twisting dismount. Good. She's going to score.
And she did score, a 9.7, putting the pressure back on Tereshcheva, who now needed a 9.8 to win.
And now we'll see what Tereshcheva can do.
Well, she's dealing from a real strength. She scored 9.85 in this event earlier in the competition, and she is a real knockout.
We could end up with a tie here, which means they have to go to other tie-breaking means.
Did you see that double pull? Wow, double full twister. It's nice to see her pulling out none of the stops, or pulling out all the stops, whichever way you want to look at it.
Notice that Ludmila also uses much lighter music than the Russians used to.
Yes, she does. Look, back with a half twist, the pike position, right into a round off the flop, back summing the tuck position. Gosh, Gosh, this gives me a thrill to watch someone work this way. What talent. 11,000 people agree, and I'll bet you four judges do too. Full twister, done with all the class in the world. You bet.
Talk about poise. Ludmila Gurascheva, she needs a 9-8 to win the gold medal. 9-9, she's won the gold medal. Ludmila Gurascheva coming from behind on the final exercise to edge out Karen Jans.
There's a smile that we haven't seen.
Gurascheva had reason to smile, for over the years, in all of their duels, Olga would win fame, but more often it was Gurascheva who won the gold.
And last of all to march out, little Olga Korbut. She learned a lot here today.
We had not, though, seen the last of Olga Korbut. Overnight, she wiped away the tears, rebuilt her confidence, and came back to shine once more in the individual event finals.
And she's having herself some kind of night.
Brilliant as she was, the judges gave her only a 9-8, and the crowd unleashed a barrage.
The crowd has stopped this meet.
And Olga Korbut sits a tiny, lonely, and almost embarrassed-looking figure.
The Soviet coach appealed Olga's score and lost. Olga, though, was anything but down. Like no gymnast before and since, Olga Korbut was at one with the crowd, and she had captured their hearts again. Undaunted, she brought to the balance beam the same daring she'd displayed on the unevens. Remember, the beam is only 4 inches wide.
Just openers for this little gal.
To dive blindly like that backwards into a chest roll, that took nerve no one had ever shown before. No one but Olga back then would actually take your breath away.
She's not too far off.
I think this is the part we're waiting for. Backflip and a front off. Look at the gal go.
Sure, get her routine. This may be the moment she's been building towards all week. If you see a 9-9, Olga Korbut's won a gold medal. There it is. You saw it just behind her. And now listen to the crowd. They got what they've been wanting since Monday night.
What an exciting little gal.
Olga, with her first gold medal now in her clutches, skipped through the final event like a little girl on the first day of school.
You can watch how she beams and plays to the crowd.
Something.
Interesting. You can tell she just feels like nothing can stop her now. Huh?
Gee, I hope she gets it.
Oh, she feels like she could fly to the moon under her own power right now. She got it! She got the 990 and another gold medal. Can you believe that? Olga Korbut has known it all this week. But she's going to learn one more thing. When you're climbing up the side of a mountain, everybody's cheering you on. But when you get there and you're standing on top, they all want to knock you off.
In 72, the men were once again dominated by the Japanese. Sawa Okato won his second Olympic gold medal in the all-around. And Akinori Nakayama won the rings for the second straight Olympics as well. The strength he displayed here was truly amazing.
He's going to lower down very slowly all the way through to a back lever pull to a cross.
The Japanese won 15 of the 21 Olympic medals, but Nikolai Andrianov was not going to let the Japanese win them all. With this performance, in fact, Andrianov served notice of a Soviet resurgence to come. Andrianov would be its leader.
Andrianov trying to make sure that the Japanese do not win absolutely everything to be won here.
He succeeded at that and won the Floor X. But the 72 games belong to the Japanese, like Mitsuo Sukihara, who gained lasting fame by inventing this vault. Ironically, while others would win the Olympic gold with variations of his vault, Sukihara did not. He did, though, win the gold medal in 72 on the high bar.
He has the highest average in the meet. He's got a 9.825 right now throughout the competition. And that's why, right up on top of the bar. And I'll forewarn you, his dismount is almost unbelievable. There's a hecked catch over the top. Now we're coming close to the dismount. Now watch for a full twisting double. And there it is. In slow motion, we're going to watch this amazing dismount again. He releases. There's a half turn, another half turn, and two complete rotations. Unbelievable.
There it is, 9.9. You'll not see better than that.
Actually, from this pigtail little girl, the world would one day see the perfect 10 tumble forth. This is, of course, Nadia Comaneci. Just 10, but already she's all business. She was plucked from the school grounds of Onesht when just a kindergartner and asked to walk a balance beam. A trace of fear meant rejection. She showed none. She displayed instead an amazing capacity for work, for endless repetitions, for long hours. She would prove Bella Caroli's theory that to wait until after puberty was to waste the best of their years. And so at 13, at an age when most girls were just beginning, Nadia Comaneci became the star of the 1975 European Championships.
And a new dismount. First time.
I just don't understand how a 13-and-a-half-year-old can have such poise.
Well, she gets tremendous height and a perfect landing.
That 4-inch-wide beam looks like a sidewalk the way she works it.
A double twist. Unbelievable.
And listen to the crowd. They just explode here.
Très bien, non? You think you're better or no?
Oui.
I just asked her how she compared with Olga Korbut. She said Olga Korbut's an excellent gymnast, but she thinks that she's just as good.
Actually, he asked if she was better. She said yes. And then set out to prove it.
First came
the American Cup 4 months before the Olympics. In Montreal, she would have to perform with a sore ankle, so this may well have been Nadia at her best in the Floor X.
Here she goes, double back. Beautiful. Wow. Excellent.
That double back somersault, that was a Nadia first. She was beginning to prove herself to the world.
Here's her last tumbling run. A double twist. Beautiful. Look at the height on that. Oh.
This performance, it turned out, was a preview of things to come.
A perfect score. 10.0.
The first time I've never seen anyone get a 10. And she deserved it. That's what's so incredible. Her match with Olga Korbut should be something else in Montreal.
This was Montreal.
And now here is Nadia Comaneci on the uneven bars.
Chris, this could be the highlight of the compulsory event. She is one of the technically strongest, best gymnasts that I've ever seen. Watch this. Beautiful rhythm, right to a handstand. Oh, look at that amplitude. Ooh. She is really moving well. Another handstand. Look at that, right to the handstand. Gorgeous routine. Beautiful, and the crowd loved it.
It wasn't just the crowd that loved it.
And it is.
A perfect 10. First one.
No gymnast in Olympic history had ever received a perfect score, and to do it with a compulsory routine was phenomenal. It brought the crowd to its feet and brought Nadia back on stage for a curtain call.
But there was still Olga to beat in the all-around competition, and Olga quickly demonstrated some of the daring that so startled the world 4 years earlier. Olga was just 21 and still as limber as ever. This great routine was reminiscent of her dazzling work in 72.
There she goes in that dismount. Full twisting front flip.
Oh,
beautiful.
Good.
Excellent. Chris, it's going to be close.
But a time deduction cost her.
Oh, 9.5.
Oh, that is definitely way out of line.
No matter how hard she tried, there was no way to recapture the magic of Munich. Those days were gone. Olga was tired.
To tell you the truth, I didn't want to perform in those Olympics, but I had to for the team gold. For me, this year practically did not exist.
The challenge would not come from Olga, but from someone new, Nellie Kim. Part Korean, part Tartar, she presented a new Soviet image, softer than either Olga or Tereshteva, but not exactly the shy retiring type when she stepped on the mat.
Double back, she starts out with this time.
Nadia came back to the uneven bars, this time with her optional routine, one that she had refined and honed, and yes, perfected.
She beat Ludmila Tereshteva on this event. Beautiful front flip. She's the inventor of that, Chris, and it will be named the Komenich front.
Tereshteva had a 9.85.
Beautiful, Hansen. There she goes in those two free hip handstands and another one right into the... Watch this dismount. Front flip, half twist. Beautiful exercise.
All right, could this be it?
Once again, she does it.
Could this be number four?
Well, I'm holding my breath.
Notice the score, a 1.00. The scoreboard wasn't designed to accommodate the possibility of a perfect 10. For Nadia, it was becoming routine.
Watch the height she gets off the bar from her hips, right into these free hips. It takes a great deal of strength, especially at the end of a routine.
She holds that so long.
She does. It's the control she has. And she just pikes right down, which is hard enough when you can hold the handstand on the floor. And a beautiful dismount, perfect.
Third event of four, an optional exercise.
As they began Nellie the third goes, rotation, Nadia was well in front. But Nellie Kim would climb past Olga and Tereshteva with this Sukahara vault by adding a full twist, something no woman had ever tried before.
Here she goes. Beautiful, beautiful vault. She's happy with that.
Nellie Kim had just become only the second person in Olympic history to record a 10. And she would do it again in the individual floor exercise. Quietly, she would win two individual gold medals, as many as Nadia herself.
Still, these Olympic Games belong to no one but Nadia. And nowhere was that more evident than on what is generally considered to be the most difficult apparatus of all, the balance beam.
I think at this point we should just watch her beauty. She does everything so perfectly. What a blind move, Chris. That is...
One after the other.
Dismount. Double twisting, full twist.
Virtuosity. Virtuosity again.
Unbelievable.
And now she responds to the throng. 5 tens by a 14-year-old superstar.
And so by the final rotation of the all-around, Nadia was so far ahead, she needed only a 9.4 to win. To protect her sore ankle, she removed some of her hardest tricks, like her double backflip. She then seemed to relax and just have fun. For the first time since the games began, we got a glimpse of Nadia's personality. At 14, she was the youngest ever to win the all-around. She had done so with the highest score in history. Still, we didn't know much about her.
There's been some controversy about the pronunciation of her name. Could she please explain to everybody out there how she pronounces her name?
Lumea nu știe exact cum se pronunță numele ta. Vrei să-ți pronunți numele tău exact?
Komenich Nadia.
She went on to score two more perfect tens for seven in all. She won the gold medal in the balance beam and the uneven bars. But remember the pigtail girl of 10, the one that was all business? Her attitude hadn't changed.
This was a normal thing that I did. It's like a job. You go to the office and you discover something. It was a great day for you. So this was a normal thing for me. So I didn't understand why they were so excited. Now I understand.
Coming as she did from behind the Iron Curtain, never smiling, never showing much joy, the Western world began to presume she was unhappy, a victim probably of too much work and too little play at too early an age. Not true, says Nadia. Not true at all.
If you do a normal thing that for you is not excited, you smile? No. You stay like this. I moved my training from the Romanian gym to the Montreal Olympic Games. I did the same routine. I was not taught to be excited about this. That's why I didn't smile. I smiled a lot all my life when I was a kid. I didn't smile when I was on the beam or on the bars. But I smile now, and I smiled before a lot. And I enjoy to smile.
And so what we'll remember is almost certainly not the smile we saw so little of, but what we saw so often.
A perfect 10.
On the still ring.
For four Olympiads, the Japanese had won the gold in the team competition. But here in 1976, as they entered the third rotation, they were in trouble. They trailed the Soviets by a point and a half. Their captain was in the hospital having an emergency appendectomy, and the alternate had just scored a 9-5 on the rings, much too low. And so Shun Fujimoto had to hit his routine so they could throw out that 9-5 as their low score. Fujimoto was certainly not one of the Japanese stars, though rings was one of his better events.
We'll see if Fujimoto can pick it up here with a strong dismount. Full twisting double flyaway.
A full twisting double flyaway onto a broken kneecap. That's what only a few people knew beforehand. The Japanese knew. Fujimoto broke it during the free exercise, but the team needed something better than a 9-5, and Fujimoto had just delivered a 9-7. But he was finished. So over the next three rotations, while the Soviets were able to throw out their low score, the Japanese could not. Everyone counted. No one could afford to miss. And no one did. In the end, out of a possible 600 points, the Japanese won by 0.4 of a point. Two of those tenths came from Shun Fujimoto, who today still walks with a limp.
His father wanted him to play soccer. He liked the gym, and there Zoltan Magyar was blessed. You see, as a kid, the gym was undergoing renovation, which ran on for years, leaving only one room large enough for only one apparatus, the pommel horse.
Considered the best horseman in the world, he does a Magyar twist. Watch this, his legs rotate one direction, but his body is rotating in the opposite direction. Incredible. Now he's still working crosswise to the horse. The only man in the world that's ever done that in world competition. Zoltan Magyar, Hungarian. It's been sensational on this.
Magyar could do things on the horse that others couldn't even dream of. At 9 days into the Olympic Games, he had to do them perfectly. Every other Hungarian had blown his chance for a gold. Magyar knew all of Hungary was watching, even at 2 a.m.
Extraordinarily difficult. Oh, yeah, tremendous.
Hey! Zoltan Magyar's countrymen could now sleep in peace. He had their gold. An American in the Olympic finals of the Floor X, that in itself was news. But what made the story of Peter Korman so amazing is that just a month before, he was just hoping to make the team, and almost didn't. And now here he was, just 0.05 of a point out of third place. He intended to make the most of it on his first tumbling run, pulling out the trick he'd been working on for years, dreaming of just such a moment.
There's his pull in, all right. You know, it's been since 1948 that an American man has been in the finals of the Olympic Games. There's his flexibility move. Now, he's got his difficulty really zonked in. What he's got to do is prevent mistakes. Very smooth press. You'll see some of the men working in short pants, some will work in long pants. Peter seems to think that he has very good leg form and wants to capitalize on it.
Mm-hmm.
Here comes his double back again. All right. Hey, maybe we'll get a medal, Chris. All right.
Peter Corman is the classic story of the underdog, the kid who saved his money so he could go off to Japan and work out with his idols like Sugihara, the kid who barely made the team, the kid who didn't even realize he made the finals until they woke him up to tell him.
He is the first American to win a medal in men's gymnastics in the Olympic Games in 1932.
There was another great talent on that Olympic team, 20-year-old Kurt Thomas. Thomas didn't win a medal, but he caught everyone's attention with what would become his trademark, the Thomas Flair.
The Thomas Flair.
His talent at this point was just emerging, but by 1978, at the American Cup, in every event, he was proving himself.
Everybody almost hit the floor. They thought he had lost it. No, that's exactly the way he programmed that routine. And Kurt Thomas is becoming one of the American superstars. And
Kurt Thomas had just served notice to the rest of the world. A few months later, Strasbourg, France, the world championships. Thomas had awakened dizzy with a touch of the flu. Then, warming up, he happened to look up just as aging Soviet champion Nikolai Andrianov missed his strength move. In a flash, Thomas's head cleared, his jaw firmed. The gold medal was his to take.
This is the moment for Kurt Thomas and for American gymnastics, perhaps.
In conversations, too, he's told me that he dreamed about this. Now, let's watch his mount. It's the most difficult part of his routine. A one-and-a-half twisting, one-and-a-half front somersault. All right!
Okay, beautiful start. Was so important.
No problem. No problem. Come on, baby. Keep cooking.
Boy, the kind of poise that takes.
Now, there's his strength hold and his press to a handstand. That's what Andrianov left out of his routine. Three straight performances. Double back.
Boy.
Boy, he's laying it in. Now watch this as Thomas Flair on the floor.
You think they're paying attention in Terre Haute, Indiana?
Oh. The crowd loves him. Listen to the reaction. My God, Jim, if this kid comes home with a gold medal.
That's what it looks like right now, unless there's a big mistake.
He needs to hit a double twister. That's all he needs. Now nail it. Kurt Thomas! Maybe a gold medal. All right, America, you got him.
It sure looks like it. He's done it.
9-9. All right, baby. Congratulations, Kurt Thomas.
The first American, male or female, ever to win a gold in these championships.
Somewhere in the crowd, Marcia Frederick felt a twinge in her heart. She had dreamed of stepping into this limelight herself. She was going to be the first American to win the gold, but Kurt Thomas had beaten her to it.
For a second there, for just a second, I said, God, if I was just a few hours earlier, and then it was gone. I said, this is fabulous. He finally did what he wanted to do, and I'm going to do that, too.
This is Marcia Frederick. For the first time in the history of these championships, an American is going into one of these finals as the leader. She's in first place, but she's drawn first starting position, and that's a disadvantage because the judges have to leave themselves somewhere to mark higher. But it's a blind draw, and that was the luck of it.
She's a beautiful bar worker. Perfect Hansen. Watch this move. Full twist. Tremendous balance. Something you don't think goes into the uneven bars, but it does. Once again, another Stalter. Gorgeous. Just beautiful. Everything is stretched, extended.
Mm.
Nice. Legs together. Hard to keep her legs together on those full twists, and she's doing beautifully. If she can get that dismount,
mm-hmm.
It's going to be a pike front.
Close to it. There it is.
Beautiful, and she can do it!
Sensational exercise by Marcia Frederick. The Americans don't seem to shake anymore. Not in this sport. It's taken a long while, but the program is maturing.
And she's milking that crowd. Well-deserved. Beautiful exercise.
Look at it. 9-9-5. You think anybody's going to beat that? Well, if they do, they'd have to get a 10.
Fame would never be hers, but the gold medal would.
Another great moment for American gymnastics. For the second time in one day, our national anthem.
And so Marcia Frederick stood atop the victory stand as the first American woman to win a gold at the World Championships. Who knows how long she'll be the only one.
Well, it's been a long climb to the top for American gymnastics, but the moments are finally arriving.
Another American favorite in Strasbourg was 19-year-old Kathy Johnson. To every apparatus, she brought her own mark of grace and maturity. It was in the floor exercise that she was best able to infuse every move with the feel of a dancer. It was not something that came naturally.
So when I first started gymnastics, dance was considered my weak point. It's because I'd never had ballet, I never had any type of dance. So I kind of had a crash course from a woman in Atlanta. And it wasn't so much that she taught me how to dance. She taught me how to feel when I dance. That a feeling has to go along with it. And that's what I was missing. I had it, but it was suppressed. And she taught me how to let it out and to show how much I love gymnastics by dancing beautifully.
That's how it happens in training, preparing for one moment in the spotlight at the World Championships. Kathy would not have made the finals had it not been for the 20-minute demonstration by the French crowd over her 9.75 in the preliminaries. The judges reevaluated, gave her a 9.9, and here she was going for a bronze. A 9.85 would do it.
Beautiful double twists done so easily. She's very turned on at this moment. I was talking to her backstage, and she was saying that she was glad she had just one event to do so she could put all her energy into it. Second tumbler, handspring front with a half twist, flip-flop, back pike, good height. No form breaks.
Very classical section here.
Beautiful.
She gets a great deal of feeling into her routines, as she herself has said.
Let's see if she can pull that last tumbling run up. Another double twist. Difficult, and he did it perfectly. She could do it.
The 19-year-old pride of Belcher, Louisiana, Kathy Johnson. She's just 5 feet tall, weighs 92 pounds, but does she carry it with authority? I should say.
Kathy got the 9.85 and should have won the bronze outright, but due to a strange twist, Amelia Eberle's score was arbitrarily upgraded by the officials, and a tie for the bronze declared.
But the undisputed star of these championships was 18-year-old Elena Mukina. 3 years earlier, Mukina had not even been a serious competitor. Then she paired up with men's coach Mikhail Klemenko. Together, they devised routines that made people gasp.
She has a spectacular move in her bar routine, something that was made famous by Gordon Maddox and yourself, right here. Only it's a full twisting Corbett. Oh. Beautiful.
Oh, my goodness. That's exactly what Olga did at Munich, but with a twist, literally. That's
exactly. She is moving so smoothly. See why she's leading at this point. Watch, heck back. Beautiful exercise.
On the balance beam, her dismount was so difficult, it was still being used to win Olympic championships 10 years later.
Here's her dismount. Watch this. Round off, double back.
Beautiful.
And in the floor exercise, she would be the first woman gymnast to take the double back somersault to a new level, adding a full twist to the first somersault.
And watch her mount. Flip-flop, full twisting, double back. Whoa. Such ease.
And she finished her routine with the kind of tumbling pass others would only dare to try at the start.
Good endurance. Double back, ending with a double back. Terrific.
Elena Mukina, unshakable so far.
She had beaten Nadia, beaten Nellie Kim, beaten the best in the world. But that was not enough. 2 years later, 2 weeks before the Moscow Olympics, Elena was trying to come back from a broken leg. She couldn't seem to master a particularly difficult tumbling run and didn't want to try. The Soviet national coach, not her regular coach, pushed her to try it again. She missed. She landed on her chin. Her spine snapped. Today, Elena Mukina blames herself for not saying no. Today, Elena Mukina is paralyzed. He may not have won a medal at the 78 Worlds, but Bart Conner made the finals of three individual events. No American gymnast had ever managed that before. And so even though he left empty-handed, Conner left no doubt he was a talent to be reckoned with on the world stage, particularly on the parallel bars. The proof came at the 1979 World Cup in Tokyo. An American had never won at this prestigious competition. But Conner took the gold from the powerful Japanese contingent on their own turf.
Swinging well? Boy, what pressure he must feel, you know? Coming in, leading the event. First time an American has ever done that.
So far, so good.
Oh, yeah. Could have some hardware in this event, Bill.
There it is, 9.70, and that's exactly what Bart Conner needed to win the gold medal.
Throughout their careers, Bart Conner and Kurt Thomas seesawed, playing out a personal rivalry that fueled America's climb. Nowhere was that more evident than at the 1979 World Championships. Thomas came to the high bar having already won the gold in the Florex and the silver in the all-around.
Here comes a Dolchev now by Thomas. All right, Kurt. Now let's hope he doesn't lose his concentration after getting past the tough part of his routine. This is a German giant done only as Kurt Thomas can do it. Yeah, double German.
9.85 will not tie him. It's 9.9 to win.
Now he's got to do his double, full twisting double flyaway. Super routine.
What a beautiful soft landing. Kurt Thomas, a new sight in world gymnastics. An American performing before a home crowd as the leader, as the favorite, and perhaps as the gold medalist. Roger Council, his coach, seems to think he's got it. So does Kurt. He has tremendous confidence, this young man. Look at him taking a bow. He hasn't even gotten the mark yet.
Isn't it exciting, though? Listen to the crowd. He has it in the palm of his hand.
There it is. It's a gold medal all by himself this time for Kurt Thomas. He's won two golds in today's competition.
On the parallel bars, Bart Conner entered the finals as the leader, but just 25 hundredths of a point ahead of two Soviets and, of course, Thomas.
And, Jim, this is really a unique mount. He'll do a free hip circle shoot to a handstand with a pirouette on top of the bars. Up, he cut out half of the... No, there he's going for it. Now he gets up and... Watch, on one bar, he'll do a press to an English handstand, an extremely difficult balance. That's really good stuff.
A 9.8 will move him ahead of Dityatin.
Oh, he's on schedule, Jim. He's got the worst of it out. Oh, he's swinging. Really setting it in. Oh, yes, Bart. Yes, Bart. Couldn't be better. Now he's got to do this and into his dismount. That's all he needs. Okay, Bart. Just hang it in there. He's going to do a double off. Best routine of the night.
Okay. Yet to come is Kurt Thomas of the United States. Could be the greatest single event in the history of American gymnastics.
Ironic.
The only man with the ability or the possibility of depriving Bart Conner of his first world championship gold medal is his teammate, Kurt.
Watch how he attacks this event. Oh, he just goes after it like a bulldog. He'll pirouette in. Diamandov, good handstand. Stitz. Now, after this, you'll see him come down under the bar. And he's going to show you an uprise. Now watch his front summy, 1.25. Well done. Back pirouette. And Kurt Thomas is in super shape at this point.
Needs a 9.95 to win.
And a double off. Look out. Two medals for the U.S. in the parallel bars.
Looks like two medals for sure, but what color they'll be and for whom is still kind of up in the air until that mark comes up. Bart Conner has won his gold medal, and Kurt Thomas has tied for the silver. The best event result in the history of American gymnastics. The Americans 1 and 2, gold and silver.
One American you didn't see competing in the 79 World Championships was 12-year-old Tracy Talavera. She was a year too young. But at the 79 U.S. trials, she wowed.
There's a front flip. Solid landing. Very blind move. You can't see with your feet where your feet are landing. Right into a back flip.
Remember, the beam is only 4 inches wide and 16 feet long.
Right into a round of back handspring, full twist. You can see why she's going to be so excited and is exciting.
A year later, this junior high phenom won the American Cup.
She has a fine routine. Look at the lift on her double back. Boy, that's sensational.
Look out now. Here we go.
The 13-year-old queen of Madison Square Garden, Tracy Talavera.
Tracy was now 13 with all the potential in the world, and the 1980 Olympic Games were just around the corner. But after the Soviet Army invaded Afghanistan, President Jimmy Carter pulled America from the Games. The best team of American gymnasts ever assembled would sit home and watch.
I had an easier time of it just because I was still 13 at the time. There was a lot of girls who made that team who were 17 and 18 at the time who hang in another 4 years. That's tough. And I could do that if I wanted to, which I ended up doing.
But Marcia Frederick could not.
I heard people talking about it, and I heard people saying, well, this isn't going to happen. This won't, so don't worry about it. And I didn't worry about it. And I was home, and I was watching TV when it came over the TV, and it was final. And I knew it was final. And at that very moment, I knew my career was over because I had lost faith in everything, in why I was training, in the people I was working with, in my coaches, in my government. It was the most awful feeling. It was like I died. And I never was able to regain the spirit that I had because I couldn't trust anybody.
The 1981 World Championships, ironically in Moscow, and this time the Americans and Tracy Talavera were there. Tracy had planned a difficult mount, but warming up couldn't hit it. The U.S. national coach told her to do it anyway, but Tracy's gut instinct said no. She used instead an old standby, flashy but not risky, but it allowed her to get into the routine smoothly. She qualified sixth and wanted a medal. She knew she couldn't afford to miss anything, and certainly not her mount. This is one time where what took guts was saying no to the coach and playing it safe.
Tracy carries in a 9.55 and is in sixth place in the balance beam.
Aerial walk over into back handspring. Back handspring, very well executed. Right on the money. Now she has to work sideways. She has to work upright, as you're seeing her now, upside down in the inverted position. There she goes. She has to work down on the beam. Got all those things out of the way. She has to also have some move in there where she does a full pirouette. There's her flare. She's nearing the end. Tracy Talavera has just turned in one heck of a performance.
Her score was only a 9.7. The Moscow crowd jeered and whistled, but to no avail. Still, Tracy Talavera jumped into a tie for the bronze medal.
In the same 81 World Championships, a young man from China, whose name is still not famous, stunned the audience with tumbling runs the world had never seen before. His name,
really
Li Yuezhu.
With a full in, full out, there it is. Double twisting, double back. This is the guy that could bring the house down. He's a tremendous tumbler. You can tell by his legs. Second pass is a round off backhand spring, pike side, one and three.
Well aware of the situation, knowing he can afford no deductions.
It's an extremely difficult routine. There's his press to a handstand, and we must hold that for 2 seconds. Another pike side somersault. And his dismount is extremely difficult. He does a full in back out. Double back with a full twist. Here's his scale, showing balance. That little beep you just heard is the timer. You have 50 to 70 seconds to perform your routine. There's his full in, back out. Beautiful routine.
Not only was his tumbling in a class by itself, Li Yuezhu was also inventive. This move, the side in 1 3/4 somersault, was now named the Li Yuezhu.
Good lift. There's the pike side, 1 3/4 to a roll.
His 9.95 gave him a tie for the gold medal. It was a first for the Chinese men in the World Championships. The Chinese had burst upon the scene, or so it seemed.
The Chinese always believed physical exercise was good for the soul. But when President Nixon visited Chou En Lai in 1972, China had been absent from world competition for a decade. This was the beginning of China's reemergence. The next year, Chinese gymnasts were allowed to go to New York for a dual meet in Madison Square Garden. And it was during that meet that Nancy Thies was enveloped in one of those rare moments that captures the significance of international competition. The Chinese pianist was asked for help. Nancy's cassette, with her music, had broken. They asked if he could improvise as she performed.
She doesn't have any sheet music. Muriel Grossfeld is over there just saying, play something.
Bill, this is absolutely unprecedented. The piano player is just going to follow.
That's right.
What Nancy does.
He's watching her. It's as if a librettist has brought some words to a lyricist.
Let's see how it works out.
See how it works out.
Isn't that nice?
And by far the loudest applause of the night. And a hand should go to Joe Chasheng. Joe Chasheng, the accompanist, does get a standing ovation. And he's being brought to the center of the net. I think she's going to kiss him.
4 years later, the Americans witnessed a Chinese team that dared to try anything, even riskier moves than Nadia, and sometimes they fell. But other times, they looked every bit as good as the Americans.
This is a real strong international class routine.
Finally, in 1979, Ma Yanghong led the Chinese back onto the world stage. Her routine on the uneven bars made it clear the Chinese hadn't just been sitting around all those years, and it won her a share of the gold medal.
I think she has the best toe point in the competition. There's another free hip, our clear hip as we call it, to a stalter, tremendous flexibility. Okay, watch this dismount. She couldn't receive a 995.
But it was the handsome, square-jawed Li Ning who took the world by storm. In 1982 at the World Cup, he first won the all-around, which normally saps even the greatest gymnast. But then Li went on to win five of the six individual events. That's almost unheard of. And with each one, he seemed to get even better.
Full in, back out, kicks out of it, beautiful. Now his second pass, again, watch the height. Round off back handspring, pike double back somersault. Little step for under rotation, but he's really up in the air. Look how stylish the Chinese are. Phenomenal. Watch this, flare on the floor, right up through a handstand, pirouette. Beautiful skill showing flexibility. Again, watch the difficulty and watch the height on this young man. Up in the air, stuck the dismount. Beautiful routine for Li Ning.
On the pommel horse, he was nothing less than spectacular. This move, a scissor to a handstand, would be named for him. But the entire routine was dazzling, and the crowd quickly realized it.
There's his flare. Very nice hip movement, stretching, pushing right up, hop. The crowd is already into his routine, and right to a handstand, another 9-9 or a 10. Watch some of the strength moves he has on the rings. There's an inlocate through to a kip. Straight body planche, holds it for the two full seconds, drops down into a cross. There's a kip. Now watch this, a straight body, straight arm press to a handstand. Very difficult. Most of the gymnasts use a bent body straight arm press. Now all he has left is his triple back somersault. He can nail it. There's a dislocate through to a 1, 2, 3. Another landing. Great routine for Li Ning.
His career would span 7 years, and he would win three gold medals in the 1984 Olympic Games. But here in the World Cup, he was at the absolute apex of his career. Li Ning was the greatest gymnast in the world, and with him, the Chinese had fully arrived.
But Li Ning wasn't the only one making history here. Natalia Yurchenko of the Soviet Union unveiled a new vault that would revolutionize the event.
And watch this, she just glides in and she'll do a round off onto the board and then a back dive.
With a full twist off the horse.
Look at it again now. Imagine what it would be like doing this back dive to the horse in order to take the full twister off of the horse. That's a phenomenal new vault.
5 years later, Aurelia Dobre performed the Yurchenko with perfect technique. It earned her a 10 and helped win the all-around at the 87 Worlds. 2 years after that, Svetlana Boganskaya showed that long legs didn't necessarily prevent her from getting incredible height. And they didn't hinder her form either. She received a 10 and clinched the all-around. And Yelena Shushinova took the Yurchenko and added another dimension, an extra twist, which gave her a very difficult, blind, forward landing. At the 89 World Championships, Alessia Dudnik scored a 10 by creating still another variation of the Yurchenko. This one astounded even the gymnastics world, a double-twisting Yurchenko.
Notice she does a round-off before she gets to the board, a back handspring onto the horse. But what makes this vault so difficult is she cranks two twists before she lands.
The next year, Vitaly Sherbo decided whatever the women could do, he could do also. Following the lead of Alessia Dudnik, he performed a double-twisting variation. Imagine what Natalia Yurchenko had started 9 years earlier was still state-of-the-art.
Look at the position in the air, and he just drops out of the sky. The year was 1983. Dmitry Belozerchev made it a year to remember. Just 16 and at the World Championships, he scored a perfect 10 in every single performance on the pommel horse.
Watch this guy work on the horse. He works transverse across the horse, gets down to the end. Now watch, he starts a flare and begins to travel across the horse in the flare and then works his way back in the same flare. Tremendous difficulty. Now he's got to show some single leg work. There's his one back scissor into the front scissors now. Back into flank circles, more flare work, through the handstand and into the dismount, and that is a fabulous exercise.
What a display of
And who else but Kurt Thomas knew what it took to do this move.
When I introduced this in 1975, it was nothing like this. Look at the flexibility in this young man. Gets his hips up nice and high, keeps perfectly straight legs, and travels all the way across the horse.
Speaking of perfection, there it is, a perfect 10.
That cocky smile of his, some resented, but there was no denying the depth of his talent, particularly his strength. Never had anyone come along at his age and been able to compete with the men, because it takes years to build the strength.
And he won't disappoint you in this event either. Now he's going to.
But Belozerchev could perform anywhere, on any apparatus, which he proved by winning the all-around title here. His point total was a record. No wonder he was at times a problem. He was the proverbial gifted child.
Boy, for a 16-year-old, isn't this a precocious gymnast?
Needs a 10 to win it all.
Eagle Giants hop over the top. Here comes his dismount. And a double twisting, double flyaway. Wow, what a landing. I can't believe the difficulty he has in every single event.
And the parade of 10 continues. Belozerchev, his third individual gold.
2 years later, a week before the World Championships, his world shattered. It was another 2 years before the world saw him again at the 87 World Championships. Anyone who knew what he'd been through would have bet against this day ever occurring. He'd wrapped his car around a tree, crushing his left leg. It was in 40 pieces. An amputation was scheduled and, in fact, was 10 minutes away when someone realized who he was. Specialists were brought in, and three operations later, he began the long, slow, and painful climb back. But here he was, once more, and certainly the strength was characteristic of the Belozerchev of old. And so were the results. Amazingly enough, he won the all-around title, plus another gold and two silvers. But it was not without having to clench his teeth every time he landed. Listen to the landing. Imagine the pain.
Oh, what an exercise.
There were times when Belozerchev thought of giving up, and his critics expected it. They'd always believed that success had come too easily. In the end, Dmitry Belozerchev proved them wrong.
Only one man was good enough to steal some of Belozerchev's thunder back in 1983. That was China's Tong Fei. Not even Belozerchev could top this. The judges would watch this routine and agree. They gave him a 10 and the gold medal. For not only did Tong have the incredible tumbling ability of his teammates, Li Yuezhu and Li Ning, but then he added a touch of elegance that was a cut above, even among the Chinese. And to top it all, he was the anchor for the Chinese in the team competition. The Chinese, for the final rotation, found themselves on the high bar and 15 hundredths of a point ahead of the Soviets. Not since 1979 had anyone even challenged the Soviets for the team title, and here were the Chinese with the lead.
A lot of pressure now. Dismount, triple back somersault, and takes a nice landing.
And the crowd here is certainly strongly behind the Chinese in their battle against the Soviets as we look at 20-year-old Su Chai-Sing.
Now, I think this is the most difficult dismount in the competition, a double-twisting, double-flyaway. And guys, they're really going for it, I gotta tell you. And if they do win the World Championships, it won't be from holding back.
China was widening its lead. Li Ning was on the bar. And then disaster struck. He got a 9-4-5. Now it was the Soviets who had the advantage, and they had Belozerchev to close.
Well, if anyone can pull it out, this is the man to do it. He's got a tremendous routine right here. Mounts with a full end, pike back out, no movement. All he has left is his dismount. Double back somersault, tuck position. Round off, back handspring, double tuck.
Well, Kurt, what a perfect time to come up with a clutch performance.
Belozerchev's 9-9-5 set the stage for Tong Fei. To this day, he remembers every moment.
Another coach came to me, Tong, can you cut your difficulty check? I said, no, don't talk to me, okay? Then my coach came over to me and said, no, don't listen to him, just do it.
The entire Soviet team now came to the edge of the floor, hoping to intimidate him.
And everybody just very quiet. I saw some people, they just bend the knee, you know, like do this, you know. I just make me like crazy, you know. Then I just, oh, calm down, calm down.
And here he is, last competitor, Tong Fei, China.
Tremendous pressure.
Mouth almost fell off, okay? I arched that fall over. My heart jumped here. Oh my gosh. That just keep going, one trick, one trick, one trick.
He's got two release moves. Here's one, a one-arm ginger. Very nicely done. And now here's the one that Li Ning fell off on, a reverse hecht. He's got to take it up nice and high, pull it over the bar, and re-catch. Beautifully done. The team pressure is on him right now. He's got to get through this routine. So far, he's cooking. Hops out. All he has left is his dismount, and this crowd is going to go nuts when he lands. Double twisting double. Beautiful routine.
I don't even think about a stick. Serious. Okay, I just say, land it. That's it. Okay, I land it. I got 9.9. And so happy.
And with a great and exciting performance by Tong Fei, he helps his team win their first world championship team title. The Soviet Union second, Japan third, the United States a credible fourth.
The Chinese came to Los Angeles and the 84 Olympic Games confident as the reigning world champions. And of course, because of the boycott, the Soviets were not there to challenge them. But we were. We had the crowd, and we were ready. We took the lead in the compulsories, but in the optionals, the Chinese came back at us. On the rings, Tong Fei dazzled the judges and scored a 10. Then it was Li Ning's turn. His routine was every bit as good as Tong Fei's. Their back-to-back routines took a big bite out of our lead. It was down to 0.4 of a point after the second rotation.
And Li Ning gets a 10 on the rings.
All right, it's a doubleheader for the People's Republic of China.
It was time for us to show the Chinese we weren't going to crumble under the pressure, any of us. And when we went to the rings for our next rotation, Mitch Gaylord set the tone.
I'm sure he wants a 9.9 or better. There's a little bit of originality, a back roll right to a cross. Obviously, he has the crowd behind him. And we'll see if he throws his half in, half out, or his triple. Half in, half out, a little safe, but that's a nailed landing for Mitch Gaylord.
10, oh my! The race is on. I'm telling you, this is really about as charged up a crowd I have ever seen.
On our last rotation, we came to the high bar. We still had just a slight lead.
He's pulling back out, piked.
He is cooking tonight, isn't he?
He really is.
On this night, we were all cooking. Tim Daggett was next to last to go with his trademark aggressive style.
Right now, he's thinking, I've got it. All I have to do is land that dismount.
And Daggett hit the routine of his life.
What a dogfight. I can't believe it.
They've got it now, guys.
As it turned out, Daggett's 10 clinched the gold. But none of us, least of all Peter Vidmark, could be sure.
Half in, half out, pike position, and they're nailing the dismounts. That might have done it. And I think that did it. Upset world champions.
Listen to this Pauley Pavilion crowd.
I can't believe it. I honestly can't believe it.
It's true, the Soviets and some of their Eastern Bloc allies were here. But people tend to forget that it was the Chinese, not the Soviets, who were the world powerhouse going into the Olympic Games. And we beat them solidly. This was no fluke. This was a great team of gymnasts. With pommel horse bronze medalist Tim Daggett and leadoff man Scott Johnson. And Mitch Gaylord, who would go on to win a silver and two bronze medals in the individual finals. And perhaps the most consistent member of the team, from Nebraska, Jim Hartung. And Peter Vidmar, who won a silver in the all-around, the highest American all-around Olympic finish ever. For all of us, it was magic. Kathy Johnson had waited 4 years for this chance. She first made the 1980 Olympic team, only to have her hopes dashed by the U.S. boycott. Now she was one of the leaders of the silver medal winning American team. That also included younger members Tracy Talavera, Michelle Desserre, and Pam Bilek. This was her chance at an individual medal on the beam. She wasn't going to let this one get away.
Best routine I've seen Kathy do.
What a way to finish.
Yes. If that indeed is her final performance, what a swan song.
Her swan song won her the bronze medal. For Julianne McNamara, the weight had not been so difficult. She made the Olympic team in 1980 at just 15, established herself with the bronze in the unevens at the Worlds the next year, and came to this event at this time at the absolute peak of her abilities.
Look at the swing. Every movement is almost parallel to the bars. That's just where she wants it. Look at each move with complete, as we call it, amplitude in gymnastics, or fullness. Right to a handstand. So far, so good. Clear hip front. Nothing wrong with that routine.
Julianne, back to her.
Great, great exercise. This means so much to Julianne. I know that she wanted this very badly. She has been such a tough competitor on this event ever since she started in international competition. Look at this dismount. Way above the bar. Stretched out landing. And no steps, no extra movements.
Well, a 10 will tie her for the gold. And it is a 10.
Well deserved for Julianne.
Gold medal for Julianne McNamara and Ma-Yan Hunt.
Ever since he was a junior gymnast in nearby Culver City, California, Peter Vidmar's passion was the pommel horse.
Talk about pressure, needing a 10 going into this piece of apparatus, the most difficult in men's gymnastics. He's got to be clean here, and so far he is very clean. There's his flare work. Again, up through a handstand. Can't hesitate or stop on this event. Scissor work. So far, so good. Back more down. And he traveled reverse travel on the horse, up through a handstand on his dismount. He might just do it.
So the former UCLA Bruin shared a gold medal in front of a home crowd.
A gold to Leaning and a gold to Vidmar.
Side mount.
Just 7 months before these games, Bart Connor had torn his left bicep in a competition in Japan and barely made the U.S. Olympic team. But here he was, tied for first with teammate Mitch Gaylord, going into the final routine of his career.
Lower down on the bar. This is where that originality comes in handy. That's all the way around the bar. Presses up to a handstand. Now is half turned to a handstand or stutz to a handstand, and all he has left is his dismount, and he nails it.
With this victory, Bart Connor became the only American to win a gold medal at the three most prestigious international events, the World Cup, the World Championships, and now the Olympic Games. And it all hinged on this landing.
The story of Mary Lou Retton begins not at the Olympic Games, but here at the American Cup the year before. Mary Lou was an alternate and had to be flown into New York the night before the competition when teammate Diane Durham, that's her there, was injured. Fate had seized the moment. Mary Lou, the alternate, won the meet. Meanwhile, halfway around the world, Ekaterina Szabo of Romania was routinely receiving 10s in the floor exercise with tumbling runs like this one at the 83 World Championships. She and Mary Lou were destined to meet in Los Angeles. But Szabo's quest for the all-around title in L.A. did not begin well. This fall in the optionals put her in a deep hole. But 2 days later, in the all-around finals, she came roaring back with sterling performances on the beam, where she got a 10. And on the floor, where her superb tumbling gave her a 9.95 and a lead by 15/100ths of a point. But Mary Lou's best events were yet to come.
And she is on. There's a dose of energy from Mary Lou. As if that double layout wasn't enough, her next tumbling run is a full twisting double back. This is what she had trouble in on the team competition. Let's see if she hits it. And she's there! Oh, very nice.
Walker got 9-9 on her second ball. Mary Lou on her way to a nice score if she maintains this.
If she can get her last tumbling run perfect. And this crowd knows what to expect from Mary Lou. Here it is. Round up back handspring. Double tuck. What a gymnast.
This was Mary Lou's first major international competition, but given her poise under pressure, you'd never have known it.
Take a bow, Mary Lou.
There's no way that you shouldn't get a 10.
That's it, a 10. Yes, Mary Lou, a 10.
Finally for Mary Lou on this event.
Standing ovation here at Pauley Pavilion for Mary Lou Reckner.
Mary Lou had pulled to within 0.05 of a point with one apparatus left, meaning a 10 by Szabo would give her the gold, and a 9.95 would assure her of no worse than a tie.
Held on to it there and is moving quite well so far. One and a half twist, double leg shoot through, putting everything she has into it. You can tell that she's controlling this routine. Getting ready for her dismount now. Double fly away, stand straight up. Mary Lou has her work cut out for her on the vault.
That misstep by Szabo on her landing cost her. She got a 9.9, and now a 10 by Mary Lou would give her the gold. She had two shots.
There is the green light.
The distance she gets on this particular vault is about 22 feet.
She has two vaults, remember. Oh, boy. Yes!
She has done the best vault of her life. She knows what she's done now. Full twisting Sugihara.
There it is.
She did it.
10, the gold medal. The gold medal goes to Mary Lou Retton. The party they'll have in Fairmont, West Virginia tonight.
And for Ekaterina Szabo, there was the ultimate heartbreak. For Mary Lou Retton, the ultimate joy. Still, all was not lost for Szabo. In fact, she came back and won 3 out of 4 individual gold medals. It's just that the one she wanted most now belonged to someone else.
Representing the United States of America, Olympic champion Mary Lou Retton.
To grow up as the youngest of 5 children in the heart of a coal mining community is to know humble beginnings. And maybe that's what stoked the fire within her. Because no one ever expected this. Dynamic little Mary Lou, 4 feet 10 inches, standing alone atop the world. Fame and the gold medal would be hers forever.
Since 1984, no one has made their mark quite like Olga, Nadia, or Mary Lou. But there have been singular moments of greatness when what seemed to be the outer limits were pushed back a little farther. Tiny Oksana Emelianchuk, the daughter of a Soviet ballet dancer, had her moment at the 85 World Championship, where her back-to-back tumbling helped her tie for the all-around title with her friend and teammate, Yelena Shushanova.
Shushanova had an entirely different style, one of incredible power and strength, achieving great height in her tumbling passes. In the prelims in 85, she and Oksana were only 4th and 5th on the Soviet team, but they were substituted into the all-around finals at the last minute and won. Elena went on to win the 88 Olympic all-around title.
Shushanova's greatest rival was Romania's Daniela Silivaș, who could tumble as effortlessly on the beam as she could on the floor. A real crowd pleaser, she would go on to win 9 individual gold medals in world and Olympic competition, more than any other female in history. But the coveted all-around title eluded her.
The Chinese tradition of innovation has continued. Lo Yun invented this move in 85, and it helped him win the gold here in 87. One of the reasons the Chinese have been so inventive is that each year they hold a competition just to introduce new tricks. And it pays off.
Her name is Yang Bo, and in Chinese, Bo means waves, which is exactly what she made at the 89 Worlds with this move on the beam. She is one of the fresh new faces who has helped push the Chinese women back into the top 3.
Another is Fan Di, whose trademark is high-flying release moves, combined with exceptional technique. 1989 was her year to shine, as she won a share of the gold at the World Championships.
On the American scene, Brandi Johnson was the acclaimed star, and she proved it at the 89 Worlds by winning a silver medal with 2 terrific vaults while competing on a broken foot. What makes her so remarkable is that as a child, she underwent surgery for severe kidney problems. Doctors insisted she would never be able to sustain great physical activity. They were wrong.
In 85, Soviet Valentin Mogilny was the undisputed champion of the pommel horse, but he was inconsistent in the all-around, and so for the 88 Olympics, he was designated the alternate. But he didn't quit. In 89, he would be the best in the world on the horse once again.
This is Tatiana Groshkova. At the 90 European Championships, she took the move Elena Mukina did in 78 and elevated the level of difficulty. A double full in, back out.
She made it.
And there's
She's
more.
She's getting ready for a back handspring. Full twist.
Right on.
Absolutely exquisite. Watch this. She will do a back handspring into another back handspring to her stomach, just in case you don't believe her.
She's 15 years old, but only 4 feet, 7 inches, and 68 pounds, and here at the 1990 World Cup, Little Lee Lee is credited with, among other things, being the first to bring breakdancing to the balance beam.
It was Igor Korobchinsky of the Soviet Union who brought a new definition of state-of-the-art to tumbling at the 89 Worlds. He also edged out countryman Mogilny for the all-around gold.
And the queen of the women's all-around in 1989 was Svetlana Boginskaya, whose name, by the way, means goddess. At 5'3", she's tall for a gymnast, and it's refreshing after years of tiny tots. The last long-legged gymnast was the great Lyudmila Taristeva, and that was 18 years ago. Boginskaya is a quiet, intense competitor. 3 days after the 88 Olympics, her coach died, and many suspected suicide. Boginskaya was left to forge ahead alone. This abstract, even disarming routine in the 89 Worlds seemed to reflect her inner turmoil, and yet she combined her intensity with incredible technique. So with the emphasis in the floor acts now on the artistic side, Boginskaya had it all, and a perfect 10 to prove it.
The perfect 10, what every gymnast strives for. From this day forward, it would no longer be just an ideal.